All rise. Please come forward. Magistrate Court of Habersham County is now in session. The Honorable Judge Steve Campbell presides.
Good morning. Take your seats. All right. This is a matter in the probate court. Looks like Lemuel Thay Pruitt on a petition for administration by Kathy Freeman, I believe.
Yes, sir.
An objection has been filed by Martha Nichols on behalf of the estate of, or by, on behalf of Judy Pruitt, who I understand is now deceased. Is that correct?
Yes.
Is the caveator or objector, Ms. Nichols, here?
Yes.
Ms. Nichols, if you'll come up and have to take a seat, I guess, up here at the other table, that would be the appropriate place for you to be. All right, this is Ms. Freeman?
Yes, sir.
Hi.
Kevin Talent, Your Honor.
Good morning, Mr. Talent. All right. So before we get started, let me just say a couple of things. And there are a couple of issues which I'd like to resolve. First of all, I guess several, maybe 2 weeks ago, I was asked by Judge Wooley to sit in on this case as she was recusing herself. And I signed an order which I believed was basically to accept the case for judicial assistance, but apparently I didn't read carefully enough. Really, the form of that request was for, apparently, for me to name someone as the judge. So with that being said, I have signed that order. Subsequent to signing that order, I became the temporary probate judge because of a leave of absence filed by Judge Wooley. So, really, there's a little bit of an issue to me. I can tell you I know absolutely nothing about this case. I have no knowledge of the particulars of any previous cases. I do know that there was a previous administrator in Mr. Pruitt's case, and I don't believe I have any, anything that would disqualify me based upon the canons of judicial ethics as it relates to anything that I have related to this case, because I simply don't have any, I don't know the parties, I don't know, I have no financial interest in anything here. So with that being said, I did sign an order, which I think was inadvertent, where the actual request was for me to name someone as judge, but I think I understood it to be that they wanted me to sit in. I'm acknowledging that, but today we're here really under the authority, as my authority as a temporary judge at the probate court. But I'll be happy to hear from either one of you all about that issue, because I want those issues to be up front and for everyone to consider.
Yes, it's my understanding that this hearing should be about you appointing a judge to hear this case.
So, let me, if you want to respond, Mr. Talent.
Your Honor, the other thing I would say is we're ready to proceed, and we certainly have no objection to the court hearing this case. What the court realized is something that I realized when I saw that Judge Wooley had signed the order. I originally thought that Judge Russell Smith had signed it under the Uniform Probate Court rules for her recusal. Judge Wooley really should have sent this to Judge Russell Smith, as the court's obviously aware, for him to then have a hearing to assign. However, I was not aware that the court is now the temporary probate court judge, and if that's the case, then, I mean, I too think that you have the authority to go forward based upon that. I would be concerned simply because of the, I would be concerned about an issue if we didn't have you sitting as the assigned temporary probate court judge. But since we do have you sitting as the assigned temporary probate court judge, I have no objection to the court hearing the case.
All right, Ms. Nichols, on behalf of, I guess since you're here as the administrator of Mrs. Pruitt's estate, is that correct?
Yes, I'm an appointed heir to Mr. Pruitt's estate because my mother passed away, and I became administrator of her estate via Superior Court from Judge Struble because of the problems I had with Judge Wooley, my sister Sylvia, and Jed Dempsey trying to forge a deed and to find out the deed was forged already. So it's just a big, big mess. They're asking me to do something that I don't think I have the powers to do, but they basically just want me to sign the deed back over to them. I have a problem with the probate petition. It's stating that my mother did that on her own illegally, when Kathy's brother, Mike Pruitt, is the one that actually forged the documents, and his friend Murray Rice is
the one. Now, I'm going to object to the scope of things we're getting into. We're just here right now trying to decide who's going to hear the case. I actually think a lot of this is irrelevant to the entirety of the proceedings today. I'm not saying Ms. Nichols doesn't need to be heard on them in some tribunal. I just don't think they're relevant to this proceeding.
All right, Ms. Nichols, I understand the concerns you have about the entirety of the case as to these issues before the court this morning. I guess I'm really wanting to know, because I have been appointed by Judge Smith to sit, and technically it's an appointment by Matt as a matter of law. The state court judge, when there's a leave of absence involving the probate court judge, is the first court in line to sit in her stead. So that's why I'm sitting here. There was an order of Judge Smith appointing me as temporary probate court judge through March the 6th. On that basis, I think I could hear it, but I also understand that there is a perhaps an erroneous order out there where I have, I think Judge Wooley and I both signed, I kind of understood it to be a judicial assistance motion or order, but in rereading it, I understand that that's not the case. So if you object to my hearing the case, I'd like to know that, and then I can make a decision about that issue and we can go forward from there.
I object to you hearing the case, yes. I think someone outside this court should hear this case.
And what is your basis for that objection?
Just because Judge Wooley appointed you, and I don't feel like that's, I mean, according to what I read, I don't feel like that was right. So I don't know your relationship with her. I don't know.
I'm not related to her. I mean, I'm a judge in this court. I've been a prosecutor in the state court and a judge in the state court going back to 1993. I've been practicing law in Habersham County since 1992. I've been a law clerk in the Superior Court in this circuit since 1989. I do know a lot of lawyers. I know a lot of people here. But I have no social, no personal, no other contact with Judge Wooley other than professionally knowing her to be someone who works in this courthouse. Other than that, that's my sole connection. And I tell you that just for your edification. My feeling about this is that since the issues have come up, and I do find that first order was really an attempt to provide judicial assistance, in my opinion, but being that was erroneously entered, and I don't want there to be any perception that affects me. But at the same time, I want you to feel confident that the judge who's going to hear your case is going to do so objectively and forthrightly and follow the rules of justice. And I think if you knew me, you would know that I take that very, very seriously. But at the same time, you don't know me. I don't know you. And that order wasn't entered. I guess the only thing I would mention going forward is this is a probate court, and in Georgia, in rural probate courts where we don't have, I think, less than 50,000 people, this is not a court of record. So whatever takes place here is entitled to a right of automatic appeal to Superior Court for a trial de novo, which means a trial brand new, a trial with no consideration of what takes place here today. So when there's that, basically this is a first step that can really be meaningless if the case is appealed appropriately. I know that in metro jurisdictions, sometimes this stage is, and you go straight to the next court because there's a lot of other rights in Superior Court that you just don't have in probate courts here. This is not a trial court, it's not a court of record. So if you're all here today, if I were to hear it, then you could appeal it and you'd be going on to the next step, regardless of what I found, one way or the other. same right to have another judge hear it anyway. So I say that just out of a kind of a judicial economy matter. I can tell you I have no interest in the case whatever, don't know anything about it other than what I've read in the petition and the objection. And other than that, I'm gonna put that to you that if you still want me to recuse myself, I will do so.
I understand, Your Honor, and I appealed Pamela's appointment of Jed Dempsey, and that's how we ended up in Superior Court. So, and now here we are today. After I got appointed, I found out, and of course contacted my stepsister, and everything in my stepfather's estate was, the documents were forged, the deeds forged. So if you want to go forward with this hearing, that's fine with me.
Okay. So if you're, just make sure, just for the record, I am sitting today by designation of Judge Smith, by appointment to sit in for Judge Wooley, and I can tell you that I have the knowledge of the case. So with that in mind, are you all right with me hearing the case today?
That's fine.
And I think that for the record, even though there isn't one officially, I don't believe I have a conflict or any other legal issue which would prevent me from hearing the case, especially based upon Judge Smith's order, which is on the record in the minutes of both the Superior and Probate Court. So with that in mind, we'll go forward. Are there any other matters that need to be raised before we begin?
I think I've subpoenaed several people.
Yes, Your Honor, I was one of those people. I was coming to be excused because I was not properly served. I received a subpoena less than 24 hours before this hearing. I know nothing about these parties, and I have no knowledge about why I am here. And I just showed up because I'm close, and I know what a subpoena is, but I was not properly served, and I know nothing of this case, and have not had any contact with any of these people, until now.
No, I don't know who he is. I didn't find out who he is.
I didn't know there was another attorney involved either. Yes, I'm Jed Dempsey.
Okay.
Yes. Jed Dempsey is an attorney.
I was the one that was appointed.
Excuse me, Mr.
Yeah, sorry.
So what I'm going to do is, I do know for the record, not the fact, there is one, I'm used to having a record here. Usually everything I say, I'm in court order taking that down in state courts. This is a little bit different. But I do know that there's a return of service on a witness subpoena to James E. Dempsey. It was filed with the court on January 29th at 12:06 p.m. And it states that on 1/26 at 6:30 p.m. And on 1/29/2015 at 11:30 a.m., I served a witness named James E. Dempsey by delivering a copy to him or delivering in person. So apparently, the subpoena states that he was served on January 29th at 11:30 a.m. Is that?
Yes, sir. Yeah, I was about 11:30. Yes, sir. Yes, right. Like I said, I understand subpoenas, and they asked, I could have been here, but I don't really know why I was subpoenaed for this matter. So,
well, I'm not sure that I have to know why you were subpoenaed in the matter at this point. I think that I do understand there's a 24-hour requirement prior to the subpoena manifesting that itself. Mr. Dempsey, however, you also are also an officer of the court.
Yes.
So I'm going to ask that you, are you going to be in your office? Are you available?
Yes, sir. Yes, I understand what a subpoena is, and as an officer, that's why I am here. I know I could have filed motions, but I did not have to come.
So there may be a point in this trial when it may be possible for Ms. Nichols, this is your subpoena, is that correct?
Yes, and he was subpoenaed in my mother's case as well, and totally ignored that, so.
All right. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to place you on call,
okay.
Mr. Dempsey,
okay.
And when the appropriate time comes in the case where Ms. Nichols wants to call you as a witness, I'm going to ask you to come to the court.
Okay, thank you, sir.
And then if the evidence is relevant to the proceeding, then the court will consider it. If it's not, then we can deal with those evidentiary issues at that time. And I'll release you until such time as you're needed.
I'll provide.
You can just provide it to
The motion.
Yes, sumo will take care of that. Did you rule out?
You got a card?
No, I don't have a card. I was going to give it, but I don't have anything. Sorry. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Bensley will be in touch. All right, are there any other preliminary matters the court needs to consider before we begin?
I have other people sitting there at the moment.
I'll be happy to discuss those with you if you'd like to, just in terms of the subpoenas themselves. If they're subpoenaed, they would need to be here if they were subpoenaed. And so are you calling them?
Do you have the notice of service in front of you?
I do have, the file does have some subpoena information. Looks like there was a witness subpoena to James E. Dempsey, one to Sylvia Tinch, one to Jeffrey Pruitt, one to Murray Rice, and one to Michael Pruitt. And are those persons here? They're your witnesses, Ms. Nichols, that you're free to call them if you wish.
Well, I mean, I guess what we need to talk about is the petition first. There seems to be some confusion with the petition that you filed, Mr. Tower.
Your Honor, if we're going to start the trial, I'd like to invoke the rule.
All right, so the rule of sequestration is invoked. What that means is if you're going to be a witness in this case and you're not a party, which is to say that you're not either A, the one of the heirs in law, we all would be parties to this. Is that correct? Is that how you understand it?
Well, Your Honor, actually, I think that the petitioner would be the only party. You know, the other heirs of law, aside from Ms. Nichols, as the personal representative of her mother's estate, have all consented to the petition. So my understanding would be that the petitioner at this point, who has, and any heir who has filed an objection, is who would
be the parties.
Be the parties, exactly. The heirs who have not filed objections and have consented, I think at this point would be fact witnesses. And that for them we would invoke, for all those witnesses we would invoke the rule.
All right, so with that being said, anything you want to talk about in response to that, Ms. Nichols?
I'm wondering is Scott, Jeff, Mike, Kathy, they're all here. All the heirs are here.
I don't know.
Well, it's my understanding that we can't have any kind of a hearing in probate unless all the heirs are present.
Kathy Pruitt-Freeman is here, my client. Mike Pruitt is here, Jeff Pruitt is here, Scott Pruitt is not here. Again, I don't think Scott Pruitt is here, I've never met him. Again, because he has signed the acknowledgement and the consent to the petition, I don't believe he is required to be here. I don't represent him, so.
All right, any response to that?
Well, it's just my understanding that everybody should be here, and that's what my wishes were, and that's why I tried to subpoena everyone, to make sure they were here, just so we could get this over with.
I don't believe everybody has to be here, particularly if they've signed a consent and assent to probate or assent to the administration.
Yes, sir.
So with that in mind, I do agree that the real parties in interest here today are the petitioner who is seeking to become the administrator of the estate and yourself on behalf of Ms. Pruitt's estate. I think that would form the parties to the action. I agree with that. So I am going to invoke the rule of sequestration so that anyone who is here who is either not Ms. Nichols or not Ms. Freeman and Mr. Talent, if you're going to be a witness in the case, you'll need to go outside the courtroom until you're called. So that's rule sequestration is being invoked. All right. And Ms. Nichols, so you'll know, that's a common rule of courtroom procedure. Is anyone who's going to testify? testify in a case and not be able to hear the testimony of the other persons who were testifying. And so the rule of sequestration is available to the parties so that they can have, when they examine those witnesses, they will not be prejudiced by what's already been said.
I understand. I have quite a few subpoenas that are not even entered in record, so I appreciate you following that.
All right. So, with that in mind, now it's like the courtroom, these the witnesses, the rule of sequestration's been imposed, the witnesses have left the courtroom. Any other preliminary matters?
Your Honor, I don't believe so. I see that I know the lady back here. She's not here to record for me, but I see Ms. Tisdale is here.
Yes.
I don't have an objection to the recording of the proceedings.
I have signed an order.
Okay, excellent.
And I believe that we, and I think that Judge, when I looked at the file, I think Judge Wooley had signed an order. I believe when somebody told me about it, I told someone with the court to contact Ms. Tisdale to tell her that that's fine. There'll be a place in the courtroom. Contact security, the deputies downstairs to try to maybe arrange it with her. So I see that that's going on. So that's all good.
Okay.
And we're good to go with that.
So Murray Rice is here?
I don't know.
She is here.
Okay.
All right. All right. Any other matters?
I don't believe so.
Ms. Nichols, anything?
I'm not sure what you're asking. I'm ready to have the hearing, so.
No, I'm just asking if there are any other preliminary matters you want to bring before the court. We've been dealing with rules of sequestration, the issue of whether or not to hear the case, any other preliminary issues other than the issues of the petition for administration or the and the caveat, which we're about to begin, if there are no other matters. I just want to make sure I get everything done so that we don't leave anything out there to deal with later. All right. So we will begin on the petition of Kathy Freeman for administration of the estate of Lemuel Thay Pruitt. A caveat or objection was filed by Martha Nichols on behalf of her now deceased mother, Judy Farmer Pruitt. Is that correct, Ms. Nichols?
Yes.
All right. So let me just go through what I believe will be the order of procedure in the case and how we go forward with this. I always believe that it's good for the court to have information, and I want the parties to be able to express themselves as allowed under the laws of the state of Georgia when it comes to civil procedure and trials. The way that that normally would operate is this. Is that each party would have an opportunity to make a brief opening statement as to what they contend the evidence in the case will be. After opening statements, there'll be an opportunity to put up evidence. We'll begin with the evidence of the petitioner, and then they will then have an opportunity to put that evidence up. You'll have an opportunity, Ms. Nichols, to ask questions of any witnesses they do put up. And at the conclusion of petitioner's evidence, you'll be able to put up evidence on behalf of Ms. Pruitt's, or on behalf, as the objecting party, any evidence you want to put up in relation to this matter. At the conclusion of all the evidence, there'll be an opportunity for closing arguments. I will listen to closing arguments from both sides. Of course, you can waive either opening or closing if you want, because those statements are not evidence, and I will not consider them as evidence, as required by law. At the conclusion of all of that, I will then render a decision. Usually in matters of this kind, I would probably take it under advisement and issue an order within 7 days would be my normal procedure. I would expect that to happen today. I like to think about things and try to make sure I get it right. So that's how we'll do it. Any questions? All right, Mr. Talent.
Thank you, Your Honor. I won't be long, and I will share with the court. I have a hope that perhaps during my opening I can clear something up that might even pave the way for us to end the hearing fairly quickly today. I'm optimistic about that, at least. My client is Captain Pruitt Freeman, and Ms. Freeman is the daughter of Mule Pruitt, who passed away, I believe it was back in 2012. It will be helpful, I believe, for the court to hear a little bit about what some of the evidence may be today if we get into that. After Mr. Pruitt passed away, his wife applied to become and did become the personal representative of his estate. Ms. Nichols has raised some issues with respect to the way that Mr. Pruitt's wife became the personal representative of that estate. Those issues are not germane to this hearing, however, because Kathy Pruitt Freeman wasn't part of any of the things that Ms. Nichols believes were done inappropriately. I don't believe that Ms. Nichols would say that either. I don't believe Ms. Nichols thinks that Kathy Pruitt Freeman had anything to do with the alleged improprieties in the way that Mr. Pruitt's wife became the personal representative of her estate. And those issues, Ms. Nichols, I believe, is entitled to have those issues addressed. I just don't think that this is the proceeding for that. What we're trying to do now, Your Honor, is have a personal representative brought in to finish the administration and finish it appropriately of the Mule Pruitt's estate. And here's why. For Ms. Pruitt, this is going to get confusing, there's so many Pruitts. For Mr. Lemuel Pruitt, he had children. His wife had children. Ms. Nichols is one of those. They did not have children together. Mr. Pruitt died intestate. And of course, as the court's well aware, when someone dies intestate, their estate is divided. A minimum of one third will go to the wife. The remaining two thirds are split among the children of the decedent and any of their living descendants per stirpes. And in this case, all of the children of Mr. Pruitt were alive at the time of his death, and they are all still alive. So the estate should have been administered by Mr. Pruitt's wife, one third to her, two thirds to Mr. Pruitt's children. That's not what happened. We believe that ultimately, the evidence in the administration of his estate, if my client is made personal representative, would show that all of the assets of Mr. Pruitt's estate were administered by the prior personal representative to herself. She gave herself everything. And it's actually Ms. Nichols who uncovered this and who notified my client about it. So she's not trying to hide any of that stuff, which is kind of why it's ironic that we're here, and I really hope we have the opportunity to clear this up in opening so we can move the administration forward. Ms. Pruitt, the former personal representative of the Mule Pruitt's estate, passed away.
And
Mrs. Judy Pruitt, thank you, passed away, and Ms. Nichols is now the personal representative of that estate. Fast forward, we are now at the point where the issues have been discovered where Mr. Lemuel Pruitt's estate was not administered appropriately. We need someone to be the personal representative of Lemuel Pruitt's estate who can deal with those issues. So on behalf of my client, Kathy Pruitt Freeman, I filed a petition for letters of administration. I was hopeful that we would be able to have all of the heirs, and that's the four children of Lemuel Pruitt and Ms. Nichols, as the personal representative of Judy Pruitt's estate, sign the acknowledgement of service, the waiver of bonds and reports and all that sort of thing. Ms. Nichols, I understand, and she actually mentioned it in her caveat, that she did not have the authority to sign anything. And so because of that, and because of some communications where I thought it was clear that she didn't think she had the authority to sign anything, we decided that we would not ask her to do that and put her in a difficult position. We would just proceed with the four heirs that we had. One was obviously missing from the petition, and we would ask to probate the estate. If the court has the file, the court will see that on in paragraph 3 of the petition for letters of administration, we very forthrightly identified 5 heirs. In fact, the first one we identified is Ms. Nichols as personal representative of Judy Farmer Pruitt's estate. If the court looks at paragraph 8, which is on the third page of the petition, we specifically said, initialed by my client, notice of this petition need not be published because we are not requesting a waiver of bond, inventory, and returns or grant of powers. Now, there was apparently some confusion at the probate court. We knew all the heirs had consented. So I'll disclose an attorney-client communication. I told my client, we don't need to try it if all the heirs aren't going to consent, because if anyone objects, we're gonna have to file all that stuff. Let's just go ahead, we'll file all the inventories, returns. I'll get into it later if we need to, why there's not a need for a bond in this case, because real property isn't included when you calculate a bond. I said, let's not even bother with it. Let's just go ahead and say we're not going to request those things. Well, unfortunately, the probate court apparently got to the back and saw before, not 5, but before selections by heirs for the other, for all those children. The reason we included them is we didn't want to have to serve them. You know, I could have left them off and then had the sheriff go serve all those folks, but they had already signed this, and so we filed this so I didn't have to serve them, but we were very clear in paragraph 8C, we're not seeking those powers. Apparently, the probate court, however, didn't understand that. That sounds pejorative.
Error.
There was an error. Thank you. thank you very much. There was an error, and so an advertisement was run in the legal organ saying that my client was asking for those things when she's not. Ms. Nichols was very concerned about that, and I don't blame Ms. Nichols for being concerned about that. Ms. Nichols has had a horrible time trying to get to the bottom of lots of different things that have gone on in previous cases. And Ms. Nichols, I don't know anybody up here from Adam's Dog or Eve's House Cat. But Ms. Nichols has some concerns about the way that prior estates have been handled. So she was concerned, and she said, I'm going to object to this. If the court looks at the objection, what Ms. Nichols objected to was if you look at paragraph 1, her concern was that in the Northeast Georgia, it said that my client was seeking the waiver of bond, the waiver of reports and returns. She never got that. Because if you look at paragraph 3, what she got was the petition that we actually filed, which is what she should have gotten, which is that we were not seeking the waiver of bonds and returns and inventories and reports. At the end of the day, I want to be very clear, and I understand this is not a court of record, but at least there are a lot of people in the courtroom who are hearing me. We're not seeking waiver of bond. We are not seeking waiver of reports, returns, or inventories. All we want is for my client to become the personal representative of this estate, of her father's estate, Lemuel Pruitt's estate, so we can then try and correct the prior administration. That may result, that could result in a claim being filed against the Judy Pruitt estate. It could also result in us being able to just get it worked out. But until we have somebody who is vested with that authority to do that, this estate can't go forward. And truthfully, neither can the Judy Farmer Pruitt estate, because if any real estate attorney runs title, they're going to come over to the probate court, they're going to see there was no will, but they're going to see that all the property went to the wife. And so that estate can't be administered either. They both need for a personal representative to be appointed in the Mule Pruitt's estate so that we can get this straightened out. I understand the need for this hearing, because I understand, based on what Ms. Nichols has dealt with previously, that she wants, I understand her wanting to hear me say that in front of a judge who could hold me in contempt if I am misleading anything. So I have no problem with doing that and coming up here and saying, we're not seeking what was sought and what was advertised in Northeast Georgia. We are seeking what we put in paragraph 8C of our petition. I do want to mention one thing before I sit down. If I need to put my client up for evidence on this issue, I will do so. We transposed her middle and last name, my client's middle and last name, in the very first paragraph of the petition. I have her listed as Kathy Freeman Pruitt. It's actually Kathy Pruitt Freeman. We just transposed that. And then at the very end, for some reason, the prayer where we asked for her to be appointed got left off. But it was in all of the acknowledgments, in a sense, and I believe that Ms. Nichols would say that she understood that what we were trying to do was have my client be made the personal representative of the estate. So I don't believe there's actually any issue there, but the prayer was inadvertently left off. I'm going to sit down now, and we'll see what Ms. Nichols has to say.
All right, Ms. Nichols, would you like to make an opening statement?
Well, just in regards to the petition, this is the petition that he had me served with.
Let's get to the mail, please.
Okay. And my concern was with Judge Wooley here in this case. I already had a case against her in Superior Court, and I didn't feel like that she should hear this case. My stepsister didn't want her to hear this case either. I think Mr. Talent is friends with Mike Pruitt and Murray Rice, and Mike Pruitt sent Kathy to see him against my wishes to handle this. What they're alleging in paragraph, well, this isn't totally different from the original petition. It's stating that my mother did that, transferred everything into her name 100%. Like she's solely responsible for that, and that they will probably only be able to recover the real property. So basically what that means is they're gonna hold my mother liable for a deed that was transferred into her name that says it was left to her in my stepfather's last will and testament. He didn't have a last will and testament. It's an executor's deed.
So where's the, that's the executor's, that's not in any will or any other document.
Everything my mother had says that she was an executor. But when my mother died, she had advanced lung cancer. She should have never been appointed anything. She died only months after she was appointed. The property was still sitting there, and the money for the stocks and bonds check was in the bank. My sister Sylvia took that money out of the bank. And the fight that I got in with the court originally was because they were trying to deed this property without going through probate. And Judge Wooley sent my sister Sylvia and Margaret and Patricia Farmer to see Jed Dempsey to try to forge a quick claim deed as though my mother did that before she died.
Well, let me just say for the record of what's going on here today, as to any allegations of any improprieties of any other parties which may be related to other underlying actions which could have to do with the administration of your mother's estate or the administration of Mr. Pruitt's estate, while those are very important issues, and I do not in any way want to slight the importance of them and the allegations that you're making on the record, in terms of what's here for the court today, the issue is solely, should Kathy Pruitt Freeman be named administrator of Lemuel Thay Pruitt's estate? That's my understanding of the sole issue. You have filed an objection, which I'm going to consider. But I think that in terms of what I'm trying to decide today, I don't think that I'm going to be able to consider what your mother did or did not do, what Mr. Dempsey did or did not do, all those things, because they would relate to a different action. It would be an action against either your mother's estate or an action by the estate of Mr. Pruitt to recover assets, however that would be done. And that wouldn't be in the probate court. That would be in a different court, I believe. But so, and let me tell you something. I believe strongly in people being able to be heard people to be heard. And I want to hear you, and I want to hear what Ms. Freeman has to say also. But I also think that I know as an attorney and as a judge, I want to be able to try to keep the issues on track with what I can consider today without getting a field of that, because, you know, as you know, in all matters of this kind, there are a wide variety of issues, and especially if there are allegations of fraud or forgery or anything else, that we could spend days looking at those issues. But I don't think I'm in any position to hear those today. So just to kind of try to help frame the debate for today, I would just say that I think that these are the issues that I want to hear about are about Ms. Freeman's appointment, whether or not you can agree or disagree with that.
I disagree with that.
All right. So with that being said, you know, then we would be going forward to make it for the court to make a decision about whether or not she should be the administrator of Mr. Pruitt's estate. So that's just to kind of put that out there so that you'll know that's where I want to, where I think this proceeding is supposed to stay, and not on the issues related to anything which might have happened with your mother's estate at this point. But otherwise, I'm just trying to kind of help direct that where we're going today.
They're seeking for her to be the administrator, and then they're going to turn around and file a claim against my mother's estate, and then file a lettuce pendens, I think, saying that the property was transferred inappropriately. I don't think it was deeded to my stepfather when he purchased it right either. I think there's also a question there. So,
and all those issues can be heard. They just, today is not going to be the day where any of those can be resolved. It's really just about whether or not Ms. Freeman will be the administrator or not. It's just, that's the only issue. What her later objectives are, those would be, they could be sorted out at that time. So anyway, if you have anything further you want to add, I'm happy to hear it.
Well, I object. I feel like that should be someone that, you know, we could trust, and I don't feel like I can trust her or her brothers now that I brought all this to their attention, and then she kind of just turned on me and said, you know, I haven't talked to Kathy since November or October. We were getting along fine until Mr. Talent got involved, and he kind of played us against each other. You know, I have been...
Let me say one thing. I think one of the things that's really important about keeping the debate and the discussion and all the things related to the court within a civil discourse is to not make accusations against folks who aren't here to be tried today. It's really important. And I know that you may have feelings about Mr. Talent, you may have feelings about Ms. Freeman, but I think it's really important to not try to raise the level of that discussion to a more base discussion of someone's motives or merits or trustworthiness unless those issues are before the court to be considered. If you have some evidence that as to would indicate why you don't think Ms. Freeman is capable of being the administrator, I'll be happy to hear that on evidence. But you better have something to back it up if you're going to make the allegation. And that's important because, you know, this process, you know, I know that you are personally invested in your mother and because she's your mom. I mean, I would feel the same way. But part of this process is to be able to have civil discourse and due process to consider the issues without getting into personal ad hominem attacks. And so that's, you know, when I'm conducting a trial of any kind, I expect the parties, both sides, not one side, both sides, all sides, to abstain from those kind of attacks unless they are part of the proceeding and the evidence of the court. I mean, I may have, you know, There are all kinds of people I can have opinions about. You can too. We can all express them outside of the courtroom. But in here, I'm really looking to keep the debate about the issues. If there's going to be some evidence about something, great. But as far as personal attacks, I would just rather those, you know, not become part of this one, so that we can keep it a civil debate. Okay? And that's a lot of words, and sometimes I get a little wordy, and I know that. But at the same time, I'm just trying to set the tone that this is an important matter. I consider it a very important matter. I'm going to consider it in a, give it all the due consideration it's entitled to. And I want to keep the debate, not personal. That's just, so with that being said, if there's anything else about the evidence you expect to put up, Ms. Nichols, I'm happy to hear before we can start.
There's nothing else.
Oh, very good. All right, Mr. Talent, call your first witness.
Call Kathy Pruitt, bring her to the stand. Mr. Mayor, before you sit down, please represent or raise your right hand. Do you swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give in the matter now pending before this court will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
May I see? Please introduce yourself to the court.
Kathy Pruitt Freeman.
And where do you reside?
Gainesville, Georgia.
What's your address?
810 Hillside Drive, Gainesville, Georgia, 30501.
How did you know Lemuel Thay Pruitt?
He was my father.
And where did Mr. Pruitt live prior to his death?
Prior to his death, he lived in Clarksville.
Okay. Do you recall the day he died?
I do.
And what was that day?
September the 19th, 2012.
Okay. To your knowledge, did your father leave a last will and testament at the time he passed away?
No.
How many kids did your father have either born to or adopted by him during his life?
Four.
And what are the names of those children?
Jeffrey Pruitt, Michael Pruitt, Scott Pruitt, and myself, Kathy Pruitt.
And how, well, rather than ask you how old, is Scott Pruitt over the age of 18?
Yes, sir.
Is Michael Pruitt over the age of 18?
Yes, sir.
Are you over the age of 18?
Yes, sir.
And is Jeff Pruitt over the age of 18?
Yes, sir.
Any other kids born to or adopted by him during his life at all?
Yes.
Any children who died before him?
Yes.
So, having said that, were all of his kids then living at the time of his death?
Yes.
Was your father married at the time of his death?
Yes.
To whom was he married?
Judy Farmer Pruitt.
Okay. And was she living at the time of his death?
Yes.
Is she now deceased?
Yes.
Who, if you know, is the personal representative of Judy Farmer Pruitt's estate?
Martha Nichols.
Is there anything that you can think of about any of those heirs we just talked about? Ms. Nichols, or Ms. Nichols as personal representative of Judy Farmer Pruitt's estate, Scott Pruitt, Michael Pruitt, Jeffrey Pruitt, or even yourself, is there any reason you could think of that those people might not be able to comprehend or understand a document such as the petition that you filed in this case when it was sent to them?
Yes, sir.
I know we mentioned that Ms. Pruitt is no longer alive. Do you recall when Judy Farmer Pruitt passed away?
I do.
And when was that?
It was in August 2013.
Okay. I'm going to hand you, first I'm going to show it to Ms. Nichols.
It's the same thing that I got from the probate court, correct?
Well,
it is, but I don't have all the other stuff the probate court attaches to it. This is what we
here, correct? With Pamela and the...
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
I did have.
That's what I felt like I should have gotten. That's why I was so upset about the one, the sheriff's office, why, you know, I served. But I've seen that, yes.
Sir. May I approach?
Drop it.
Ms. Freeman, I'm going to show you what's previously marked as petitioner's exhibit one. Do you recognize that document?
I do.
What do you recognize it to be?
The petition that we filed for me to be appointed as administrator.
Take a second and look through it, and when you're done, let me know. Is that a true and accurate reproduction of the petition that we filed in this case?
It is.
Your Honor, I move to admit petitioner's exhibit one.
Any objections, Ms. Campbell?
No.
Submitted.
I'm going to direct your attention to paragraph three. How many people are identified in paragraph three?
Five.
Okay. And is it your understanding, take a read paragraph three and tell me what your understanding is that this paragraph three was identifying?
That all five of the people would meet to agree or disagree about this, or that they would have an opportunity to sign or
okay. not sign. Who are those people, according to what you understood this document?
Judy Farmer Pruitt's administrative representative, which would be Martha Nichols. My brother, Scott Pruitt. Mike Pruitt, my brother, Jeff Pruitt, my brother, and myself.
And those are the people who you identified earlier when we were talking about kids and
correct.
Wives and that sort of thing. Thank you. Sorry, my question wasn't very helpful. And how many, actually I'm going to show you this page. Take a look at that page. Is that your signature on it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And what is it that you understood this document was? I'm looking, Ms. Nichols, if you have a copy you're following along with on page six of what we originally filed.
I think Judge Campbell has my copy of that. I have what I got from the court.
If maybe you want the service sheet on it, Your Honor.
All right, let's see.
This is what's in the actual file in the probate court.
Okay, now getting back to the page that we were looking at, and you, was this or was this not your signature?
My signature.
Okay. What was it that you understood this document was?
I was requesting the opportunity to be the administrator to my father's estate.
Okay. And then, who was it that signed this one?
Jeff Pruitt.
The one that Jeff Pruitt signed, is it the same form that you signed on the previous page?
It is.
Who signed this one?
Scott Pruitt.
The one that Scott Pruitt signed, is it the same form that you signed on the previous page?
Yes, sir.
Who signed this one?
Mike Pruitt.
Is this the same form that you signed on the previous page?
Yes, sir.
Is there one of these which was signed by Ms. Nichols as the personal representative of her mother's estate?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm then going to ask you to take a look at paragraph 8. Are those your initials?
Yes, sir.
Did you put them there?
I did.
Okay. If you would, please read aloud what paragraph C says.
Notice of this petition need not be published because the petitioner has listed all heirs at law and their addresses, and petitioner is or not requesting a waiver of bond, inventory, and returns, or the grant of powers contained in OCGA 5312261.
Thank you. Are you willing to file an inventory in this case of the assets that you believe make up your father's estate at the expiration of 6 months from your bond?
I am.
Are you willing to file annual returns and a final return as to what actions you take with those assets as administrator of your father's estate if you are appointed?
I am.
Are you willing to post a bond if the court should determine that you need to post a bond at the end of the day?
Yes.
To serve as the personal representative of your father's estate?
I am.
Are you requesting any special powers today be given to you, kind of a blanket, such that you would be able to go out and just sell property or do stuff like that without first seeking the court's approval?
No.
May I say something, Mr. Talley?
Just 1 second. If you have an objection to what or something to what's just to be said, you can, but otherwise you would need to wait until you conclude.
Well, the estate number is different, so.
I understand.
Okay.
If there's an objection, we're just going to follow a civil procedure here.
Thank you.
While we're on that, let's take a look at there appear to be two estate numbers written in at the top of this page. Do you see that?
I do.
What is the first one?
Typed in as 5427103.
And what is the next one?
5631156, handwritten.
Is that your handwriting?
No, sir.
Do you know whose handwriting that is?
No, sir.
Did you see anyone handwrite that?
I did not.
I want to talk a little bit about, and just briefly, about your history, if any, with regard to the prior administration of your father's estate. Were you the personal representative of your father's estate at any point in the past?
Yes, sir.
Did you have anything to do with the transfer of any property either into or out of your father's estate at any point in the past?
Yes, sir.
Guess while we're on it, are you aware of any bank accounts that you know of that still exist in your father's name?
Yes.
Are you aware of any property that is currently titled in your father's name?
One piece of property.
That's currently still titled in his name?
Pardon me, no.
Okay. Are you aware of any stocks or bonds or vehicles that are currently still titled in your father's name?
No, sir. Okay.
No further questions for the witness at this time, Your Honor.
All right, Ms. Nichols, do you have any questions for this witness?
This is a copy of the actual file that's in the court, and I think that's what we have to go by.
If you will, if you'll take these to bail us, we'll be able to speak with us. We just have some
procedures
on the bottom. Thank you. What is this?
This is the petition that's filed downstairs in the probate. That's the.
We'll show this to Mr. Talent, please.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're under no obligation to answer my questions. You're not under oath.
I'm just trying to facilitate.
I understand.
Okay. May I show this to Kathy?
You may. You may approach the witness subpoena.
Okay.
You'd like to.
Did you ever get a copy of this?
I did not.
There's several pages there. And they have different case estate numbers on them.
Okay. So Nichols, I'm looking at the, what I believe is the original petition file. What I show is something that says estate number 5127-103, and there's a little handwritten dash old, then 5631-156-new. Is that one of the things you're talking about?
I'm talking about the notice of service certificate of service, notice of service, the entire petition that's in the court. I think you only have what Mr. Talent filed, correct?
I have what Mr. Talent filed and whatever else is in probate court's file, so if you received
it. Where are they sent to the Northeast Georgia and where Kathy was asking to be? Okay.
I do have that.
All right.
So let me just say that if there are procedural issues related to the petition which you want to discuss, it may be in the form of a motion that if you believe that somehow that either A, anything in the file would disqualify it from being considered as a petition, or anything that I should consider as to the validity of the petition, I'm happy to hear that. I think that from what I can tell looking at the file, there are notations on the court, on the probate court's file. There are other notes that seem to be handwritten on some of the pages that talk about the, looks like on the petition for letters of administration notice, there's some handwritten notations. Also on the certificate of service, there's some handwritten notations. And to the degree that that's an issue, I want to consider it if you have an objection or a problem with the petition in and of itself. Because I don't think she would know necessarily anything about notations made on the petition by probate court staff.
What ran in the paper is something that I should have answered, I believe. Kathy was petitioning the court to be the administrator of her father's estate. She was also asking for grant of certain powers and waiver of bond. Is that correct? According to the petition that Judge Wooley signed and sent. Now that seems to be...
I think on the record here today, it's been made very clear by the petitioner that she is not seeking a waiver of bond nor a waiver of any of the other requirements of the petitioner. And that I think that they have claimed that the notice was in error and that it was not their intention to have a notice published that stated they were seeking to be relieved of the requirement of making a bond or filing an inventory for other reports.
And
so they've waived all, they've said basically none of that is true, that's a mistake or an error has been made, and that they are agreeing to file all the reports and all do all the things required of an administrator. administrator and are not seeking a waiver. That's my understanding.
Okay. As long as that's what's actually
happening. That's what I've heard here today, anyway. That's what I understand. They've talked about paragraph 8C at length, and which states that they are the notice. They're not requesting a waiver of bond.
Yeah, and I had tried to speak with Mr. Town about that as well, and he totally ignored my emails and didn't answer. So now he wants to say that they're not doing that. We could have done this without coming to court, so.
You know, let me just say that I think that what I understood Mr. Town to say really from the very beginning today was that his hope was that because they are not seeking a waiver, because Ms. Freeman is willing and is not, she's willing to file inventories and file petitions and reports and will post a bond if required, that I think that's why he stated at the beginning he was hopeful that perhaps there would be some resolution today of those issues, because the concerns you have and the concerns expressed in your objection, they're acknowledging that you should have had some concerns based upon the notice that was put in the newspaper, because they are not seeking a waiver.
I've actually been bonded for the things that are left in the estate, so Mr. Talent was talking about property bond. Judge Struble made me get bonded for that piece of property, so I'm already bonded for it.
Right.
I need to be relieved of all of that, and if that's what she wants to do, that's fine, but I don't want to be liable for the things, the damages, what's missing, and, you know, it's my understanding he was going to file a claim, and that was my concern, so.
I think there seem to be a couple of different things here. I think that the issues relating to your mother's estate are not before the court. It does appear to me, based upon the statements made, that there are some concerns about the property received from Mr. Pruitt's estate and as to whether or not it was distributed pursuant to the intested secession laws of the state of Georgia. Now, but that's, again, a hearing for another day to make any determinations about that. There are any. And I don't know of any that are pending in this court at this time. Again, the sole issue for the day, my understanding is that whether or not Ms. Freeman will be made the administrator.
And
according to her petition, she will not be relieved of any of the obligations of inventories, petitions, and perhaps a bond depending on the circumstances.
And Judge Wooley will not be the judge in that case, correct?
She will not be the judge in that case.
Okay.
At this point, I am the judge in that case, though it could be that, because I know that she has recused herself from consideration of this case, I would expect that to go forward without anything to do with any of the Pruitt matters, would be my expectation. I'll be happy to hear any of them.
Well, I just didn't feel like I had permission to do anything without the court's permission and my siblings' permission, because I was never granted any powers. I was just only appointed administrator. And once I found out with all the other things, I didn't even seek those powers. And all they basically wanted me to do was just sign the property back over, and I can't do that. So I don't have a problem with Kathy being the administrator of her, if I legally can sign something saying that she can do that. But as far as her being bonded, held accountable for, whatever, I feel like that, you know, just because of the trust issues, what she was asking in her petition and what she signed was just basically to do whatever she wanted. And that's kind of what happened with the original petition that you didn't know about until I brought that to your attention, and with my mother's petition, that's what we all, my sister, you know, to be held accountable, and then, of course, that was a typo in the paper as well, so that's why I'm so concerned about the difference between these two, and I guess you can understand that. But sure. I don't have any objection to Kathy being the administrator. I have a huge objection to Mr. Talent being the attorney involved in this because of his relation with Mike Pruitt. That's just
okay,
my.
Okay, so to break that down, you don't have any objection to Ms. Freeman being the administrator?
I don't.
All right, so with that being said, my understanding is that there have been four acknowledgments and basically assents to the administration filed by Scott Pruitt, Mike Pruitt, Jeff Pruitt, and Kathy Freeman. And you, as the administrator of Judy Pruitt's estate, do not object to Kathy Freeman serving as the administrator of Lemuel Thay Pruitt's estate. Is that correct?
If I can legally sign a document stating that.
Well, I think that today I might be able to make it so you don't have to sign.
Okay.
Because we're here today on that issue, and if everybody is in consent that Kathy should serve as the administrator, then I can simply sign an order granting her letters of administration. Because we've had a hearing, you basically decided to withdraw your objection to her serving, and then I can enter a letters of administration. So that issue is resolved. That's what I think we're here about today, isn't it?
Yes, Your Honor, it is. That's the issue that we are, absolutely the issue that we are here on today. I was going to try and pull the code section, but I lost my connection to my hotspot that actually says that she can be the person who gives that consent. I understand that she didn't feel like she could sign giving all those powers and stuff, but in any event, I
think she does have the authority to sign it. I just wanted to, if she had a concern, I wanted to relieve her of that concern that we could do that here today.
Yeah.
Since if she doesn't object and is waiting.
Well, I have a lot of concerns, but we can't get to those here today.
That's
You're just
correct.
Wanting to talk about administrator.
That's
I have,
right.
You know, that's fine as long as Kathy and I can work together. And that's what we were doing to begin with. And that kind of, we went in opposite directions, so.
Well, I think that if you are going to agree that she can serve as administrator and basically withdraw your objection to her serving as administrator of Mr. Pruitt's estate, then you can begin that conversation and try to get these issues resolved. I very much encourage you to use the opportunity to try to find a way to address the issues that are underlying between the two estates and resolve them.
And then as far as the liability and damages caused to the heirs, that's something that we'll take up in another court, is what you're saying?
Likely. I mean, there are issues that probate court can hear, but a lot of other issues really sound like superior court issues to me. That's just my take on that.
Or magistrate court?
Never. Never a magistrate. Magistrate has no jurisdiction over things like this.
Does the court want to hear anything on bond?
I do. I do note in the petition, Mr. Talent, that there is a listing of some assets, but apparently none of those are currently in Mr. Pruitt's estate. Is that correct?
That's correct, Your Honor. That's the testimony that I elicited earlier today. It is our position, Your Honor, that at this time, while she's not relieved, this is going to sound equivocal, but I hope everybody will hear me out. While she's not relieved from the requirement to post a bond, there's nothing to post a bond on at this time. The biggest asset, and the one which we most hope to be able to recover and do something with, is the real property, either working in conjunction with.
That's currently not in his estate, is that correct?
That's correct, and even if it was 53-651, and I think it's C, says that we don't include real property in the calculation of a bond until such time as it's converted to personal.
And I'm familiar with that part of the statute,
yes.
and I realize that if it's real property, that no bond is required because there's a piece of property. It's kind of easy to track that.
Yes, sir.
If I may, I've been bonded for that property. I've been bonded for my mother's property that we lost in foreclosure. I've been bonded for things that are already taken out of the bank. So I'm not sure what you're talking about, but Judge Struble ordered me to get bonded for that property. That's the only thing left.
Let me just kind of go through that analysis. My understanding is that there was some real property, whether it was a home or just land or what, I don't know what it was. Can y'all?
There's a home on the land.
There's a home on the land. And that was then transferred by deed to
Judy Farmer.
To Judy Pruitt.
Yes, sir.
So that deed is no longer in the name of Lemuel Thay Pruitt, is that correct?
Correct.
Are you aware of any other personal property of Lemuel Thay Pruitt, which personal property, I mean, whether it's cash, items of personality, cars, vehicles, anything that would be his, or which currently is in his, is currently in his name or in the, or should be in the possession of his estate?
There's some things, I don't know what the things are, at an auction house that I don't know if they're in Judy's name or his name, but there's nothing of any value, sentimental value perhaps.
I made sure that Kathy got all of the things. She was in court at our last hearing, and I made sure that Judge Struble allowed her to get her father's things. The only things that we knew that were left besides his property, so.
I think the challenge with Nichols is this, is that apparently most of, if not all of the property that would have been Mr. Pruitt's property at his death has been distributed in some way or the other, whether it's personal items to Kathy or other children, whether they're things that Mrs. Pruitt received, so that basically those things have already been distributed, so there remains nothing in the estate, though that there may be, in the form of this piece of property, something which may, which could, not to say that it will become, but could become a part of the estate. Is that correct?
Yes. At the time of his death, though, someone was making mortgage payments. Someone lived in the home, and she had lived there for 13 years and was making mortgage payments on the home. And so it really didn't belong to him. And then after my stepfather died, Miss Ivory got Legionnaire's disease, and she had to move back up north. So my mother had to, I made sure that she followed foreclosure proceedings after I became administrator, but I've spoken with Miss Ivory, and she voluntarily left the home because the house was falling in. My mother and stepfather would not sign off on her getting help from District 9 to fix up the house. So, but at the time of his death, someone else was actually buying the home, so.
All right. Well, I think an essential part of the bond requirement is that there actually be property which is in need of a bond. There would be something there to, a reason for posting a bond. What I will do is this. I will sign letters of administration for Ms. Freeman. She will be required to give an inventory and file returns and all other requirements of administration. As to the bond, I would like for you within 30 days, Ms. Freeman, to do an inventory to the degree that one can be done and report back to the court of any personal property, excluding real estate, that is the property of the Lemuel Thay Pruitt estate for which you can become in possession. And if there is any personal property of that kind, then I will require a bond to be posted for that. But I'm going to give you 30 days to look and do that inventory to let me know so that I can actually know what property there will be for a bond to be necessitated.
I think we pretty much know that the only thing that's left is this piece of property, Kathy. I mean, we've made that.
Let me just say, I'm doing that just for the courts, so that I'll feel confident in that, and I'll have something on the record that I can know it. Y'all may be able to come to that agreement, and maybe you just come back and say there is nothing else. But I think that, just for the record, I would like to have that inventory done.
Okay.
requesting that that would be a part of the order. Mr. Talon, if you will prepare the letters of administration and order.
Yes, sir.
With that language in it, and then I will execute that just as soon as you can get that to the probate court. And of course, I do remind both parties that regardless of this decision, that there is still the right of appeal, and you have 30 days to appeal that decision to the Superior Court for a trial de novo, if you wish.
Thank you, Your Honor.
That's the order of the court. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes.
My bond, I don't understand what you're saying. The only thing that's left in either estate is this piece of property.
You said you were bonded, that code section?
I was required to bond, yes.
In that code section, you can file a motion on that code section to have your bond lowered, so you don't have to.
Judge Trouble wouldn't do that, so.
I'm sorry.
I understand all about this, but.
Ms. Nichols, this morning I received a letter from you. I did not open it, only because I
don't know.
It's just where I had requested to record. I assume we're going to have a court recorder here.
Because it's not a court of record, we don't have a court recorder. You are free to bring one.
It's the opposite of what we use.
Courts are, you know, 159 counties in Georgia. Every place is a little bit different. I think in the metro, you'll see more court recorders available in probate court. It kind of goes a matter of course.
I understand.
So that's really, if you were free to record it, say, we have video recording, so it's all there. Thank you. Thank you, everybody, very much. But I think that was.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Easy to deal with. Thank you.
I appreciate it.
All right, so that copy, that's not law.
That is the exhibit that was admitted.
Do you want?
I have more copies, Your Honor.
I will place this in the record as plaintiff's one, just
in case there's an appeal. So, yeah, absolutely.
You bet. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor, for allowing me to record this morning. And also my Rule 18 request to record, will that be put on the record as well?
I have signed that, Ms. Tisdale, and I will make it part of the record.
Thank you very much, Your Honor. Have a good day.